Very happy to be here. This is also an anniversary because usually they don't let me on stage without someone to mind me. That's the whole reason. Thank you for people here for the second, third time. You may notice I've escaped my minder. And the person interviewing me is used to be a high-ranking official of the U.S. government, and he doesn't tell you that, and he's ready to reprimand me to some unknown place if I go offline. But it is a momentous occasion for Palantir, and I would say for our journey, and I would, and that journey began not very far from here. I don't mean the time Peter and me in the dorm fighting with each other, although that's where it began at Stanford. And it really began with a central set of ideas, of course, the most important one of which was we've got to make our institutions actually work, which means you put more in, less into the system than you get out. A very simple idea. Every business in this room works on that internally. You build something efficiently that's better than your competition in a way where you get a margin. And that idea was in Silicon Valley. One was the building block of how Silicon Valley was built. It meant you built things for the US government, they actually became valuable, and then you sold them to primarily to America and the rest of the world. And because you had done all this high-end R&D, and not just done it, but done it in a way where it actually worked with the most interesting, innovative people in the world doing it, you could take those products to the world. And that actually is what built a lot of what made things work in this country really well and brought our country together in so many ways and has led to a dominance it's like this weird thing where 84% of the top 50 companies in the world are American, and almost all of them that were started here. And then ways of doing things, ways of working together, ways of innovating that were unique. And then, of course, we lost that and had a wave where basically people built technologies where the person they're selling it to was de facto the host, and the people selling it were de facto parasitic. And that's what consumer internet basically is. You enjoy yourself, they make all the money, and you get slower and dumber, and you enjoy it. You know, so it's like, I'm getting slower, I'm getting dumber, and every day I enjoy it more somehow. It's like, the slowness. Exercise for my mind, don't need that. And this company and the products we built, leaving aside the kind of pro-West thing that I'm very proud of, was built on the simple idea that our U.S. government clients primarily, although we have allies from almost every country in the world using our product, would get more value from the product than what they were paying for. It would not only make their institution work, but it would work better. So the first product we built was built to increase civil liberties and decrease terrorism at a cost that is very small for what we built. Now, if you fast forward to now, when we launched, first we launched this product Foundry, and then we built some things in the US government and commercially, the ontology, which is now becoming famous, other parts of our product. The whole reason these products were built years before anyone thought of large language models was that we built a culture around, well, what should an enterprise, what ought to an enterprise want? If you took the enterprise and reduced it to what it ought to want to do with its software, what it ought to want to do with its production, if what it ought to want to do on the battlefield, meaning, as was mentioned, the battlefield doesn't even work unless it's software imagined and generated. And then in the commercial context, how would you deal with a very harsh competitive environment where you have varying quality of assets, supply chains being disrupted, you have to make people work in manufacturing as if they're from a different country in this country, you have to reduce your margin, you have to reimagine your supply chains, and what would the attributes of a software platform look like? And that's how we came up with Foundry and the ontology and all these things. It almost looks like magic that they now exist. You have this incredible revolution. And then the revolution is really confusing. it's confusing because some large language models create value. Large language models do certain things well, they don't do other things well. You have PowerPoint production, which is a plight on our society. And I was like, get rid of the PowerPoint. That, you know, like, we at Palantir do things mostly for good reasons, but I, not anyone else at Palantir, also do things to humiliate people selling PowerPoints. That's the, no one at Palantir would do this, but I do it, and I love it. The whole reason for the boot camp is to, one, show you something in action, something that is yours and that you own, that creates enormous value for you, more value for you than what you're paying us, and shows you how you can reimagine your enterprise. By the way, it's an enormous advantage in this country because people are maximally willing to change, learn, be meritocratic compared to any other country in the world. And so it gives a disadvantage to America. It is a disadvantage to the rest of the world. It's a massive advantage to America. Industrial base in America can be reimagined. Enterprises can be rebuilt. The rest of the world is not moving this quick for lots of reasons we could go into. It's a massive advantage for our warfighters, people protecting us because they can reimagine it. And I have to admit, it's very humiliating to people selling PowerPoints and steak dinners, which I love. And I think, by the way, when we people, you guys are also tired of, you can get a steak dinner yourself. You don't need the steak dinner. You all can buy it yourself. How about your enterprise reimagined and no steak dinner? That's what Palantir is offering. And I find it super gratifying that we at Palantir and you, our partners, many of whom I've met here or will meet, are playing an enormous role in a crazy and interesting revolution. Much bigger. You know, so the other thing, the reason why people don't realize the revolution is people assume a revolution is associated with long, off-colored hair and psychedelic drugs. And some people here have that. But it's not, it's like, actually this revolution is being driven by people in this room, and it is going to have an enormous impact on America, on the rest of the world. And at the other thing about this that's really cool is mostly, since a lot of these things people talk about weren't really true, you could wait. But what really is happening here is the early movers are going to move much quicker and much faster. And those, by the way, we have a whole bunch of people in London who are here. So this is like America, England, all these places galvanizing. But the early movers are going to have an enormous advantage over the people that wait, precisely because the incremental value is not incremental. And it's like every day you wait is a day where you can't catch up. That's the advantage of Silicon Valley over the rest of the, and America over the rest of the world. That's the advantage of Palantir, given that we built these things. And quite frankly, that's the advantage of everyone sitting in this room, that you can actually begin to reimagine, rebuild your enterprise in hours, while somebody else around the world is hearing from somebody who's telling him this stuff isn't real. And with that, I'd like to welcome you. It's tremendously exciting. For me, it's like a real high point to be back in Palo Alto with such a tremendous group of people and my Palantir and colleagues. We have a really good vibe on our end. You know, it's, and most people at Palantir didn't get to do a lot of winning in high school. So it's kind of... Kind of nice. It's a new vibe. Yeah. So, any case, with that, very, very welcome. Very happy you're here. And glad to be partnered with you. Bye.